Greetings of the day, everyone, and privileged to welcome you all in the third edition of Aurangzebi Literature Festival, organized by SGR Foundation in association with GH Rajshahi University, powered by Rajshahi Groups of Institutions, a platform that celebrates experiences, narratives, and emotions from all walks of life. Having said that, that is thrilling to be here with you all today. I am Aditi Mudra. Delighted to be your anchor for today's session. Jennifer, one woman, two continents, and a trip called child trafficking. Where we have Ms. Nandita Ohuri ma'am in conversation with Ms. Bertha Master ma'am. Nandita Ohuri ma'am was born in Calcutta and spent her early childhood in a boarding school in the former French colony of Chennai. She studied in Calcutta and Bangalore, majoring in English literature, and worked as a writer and journalist with several newspapers like The Telegraph, The Statesman, The Times of India, The Reader's Digest, and others. For nearly a decade, she wrote one of the most popular weekly films called Fox Cinema, Fermenting, Potpourri, and India's largest circulated daily, Daily Khasar, Khas Chahre. In 2010, Nandita ma'am published the biography Unlikely Hero. Ohuri, which has been on the bestsellers list and translated in several Indian languages, including Hindi, Punjabi, Malayalam, and Marathi. The following year, Nandita ma'am also published a debut novel, Two Worlds, by Rupa and Amu, a historical romance spanning two centuries and several continents. The book was launched at the Jaipur Literature Festival in the presence of Farhan Pamuk. It was on the bestsellers list for several weeks. Nandita ma'am has been a member of the script committee of NMDC and CFSI, as well as a TEDx speaker. In 2017, she launched the Ohuri Foundation at the 70th Cannes Film Festival in the memory of her husband. Internationally acclaimed actor Ohuri to carry his legacy and philosophy ahead. Currently, she chairs the Ohuri Foundation. Nandita ma'am has been working and researching on the sensitive subject of international child trafficking and inter-country adoption since more than 3 years. Now, through the personal story of Jennifer Haynes, the book Jennifer's Story is published by Rupa Publications on February 20. She has completed the screenplay Homeless Lady Hoover based on her book Jennifer's Story. It's an honor to have you with us, ma'am. And this gets even more delightful as we have Ms. Bertha Master ma'am, who will be in conversation with her as the moderator. Ms. Bertha Master ma'am is a senior journalist working for English dailies in the city for over 2 decades. From features to interviews of celebrities and sharing stories of big achievements by ordinary persons have all been a part of her writings. She is also a columnist, blogger, and an author, and has taught writing to students of mass communication. I once again welcome you both. Now, my dear audience, you are about to experience a conversation between two extremely dynamic individuals. So without skipping a moment, I humbly invite Ms. Bertha Master ma'am to lead us ahead.
Hello, all of you. We are here to talk about a book which is extremely sensitive in terms of its subject, and it is also very revealing, you know, in terms of what can happen when people are not on the right side of law. So let me begin by reading out a few lines here, and then you get a hang of what the book entails. Yes. I just read 3 lines and you'll have an idea of what the book says. I was walking like a pendulum with my feet chained and carrying the garbage bag across my back. I was looking like a fucking Santa Claus, an Indian version of Santa Claus. So this is the story of Jennifer. I understand that Jennifer is seeing this. So tell us, how did you come across Jennifer?
Well, Jennifer, briefly to tell you, as an 8-year-old, she is an Indian, she belongs to a Keralite Malam Christian from Ambernath near Thane in Bombay. As an 8-year-old, she was trafficked out of India into the US under the garb of adoption. And for the she was sexually abused by two white American fathers. And then by the time she was 18, she had, you know, changed 50 foster homes. And then after she finished at the age of 18, she got into drugs. She was, you know, hustling in drugs. She was abusing herself in drugs. And finally, she married a fourth generation drug dealer. By the time she was 24, 25, she became mother of two children. And she was busted undercover, she and her husband. And the husband was sent to jail. And she was deported to India because the papers were not in order. Now, as an 8-year-old to a 28-year-old, 20 years you're in the US, you are an American for all practical purposes. So, to be thrown into a city, you know, nothing of, it's very, very, you know, what do you say? Intimidating, and you don't know the language, you don't know the culture, you don't know anything. So that, and when she comes here, she didn't have a passport.
She's practically an American otherwise.
Otherwise, American. Even now she talks like an American. She thinks like an American. Her children are American. She's married to a black American, you know. And from there she started her life again. She got a passport. She found where her parents were. And that's when she found out that she was not sent out for adoption. She was under the cover of it. Adoption trafficked out. So that was very, very worrying. And again, of course, given that she left her 4 and 3-year-old children in the US, her husband in jail, her mother-in-law looking after her children, so she just got back into drugs. And she was again arrested, and she ended up being sharing, you know, in Baikala prison with Rani Mukherjee. So,
and how did you come upon Jennifer?
So, there's an organization called ACT Against Child Trafficking. It's based out of Brussels, and they have two Indian lawyers in their panel. And one of them, Pradeep Aghur, was Jennifer's lawyer, because Jennifer needed to go back to the US. But she got a 20-year ban from the US, from entering the US. So, they on humanitarian grounds, they pleaded a case in the Bombay High Court, it didn't work, went to the Supreme Court, it didn't work. So finally, they wrote to Barack Obama, and obviously he couldn't do anything, immigration laws are immigration laws. So that's when ACT came to me and asked me that, could you write on Jennifer? So they gave me this much high pile of legal papers, and they said, just read a case. And all the organizations in the world who are involved in child trafficking and how this happened to her, and please write. So it took me about 4 years to get her story, interviews. She was by the time quite, you know, with all the drugs, totally off. So it was very difficult interviewing her. It was very difficult getting the, putting the information together. And after that, it was more tough. Lawyers running to and fro to, you know, from both from the publisher's side and others to see that, because we pulled in a lot of organizations so that we don't run into, you know, run around courts. So it took about 5 years.
Basically, she, her case was being taken up by most of the international organizations.
Only this organization, ACT. And of course, there were a lot of organizations helping also, but yes, ACT had taken up.
And all the while she was in jail in India.
She was not in jail. She just went into jail for 3 to 4 months. In India, she came without a passport, got a passport, worked in call centers, then got into drugs. Because in the US, she was in drugs, it was the same thing, you know. So that's how she got into drugs, and that's when she got caught and she was put behind bars.
This voluminous legal paperwork, etc. I mean, what was the research like for this book, and how many times did you run into legal hazard writing it?
It was a lot of, because child trafficking, inter-country laws are not my cup of tea. So I have to read out, I have to read the UN law. The basic law in India is, if you are, say, from Punjab, and you want to adopt a child from Kerala, they will not give you, they shouldn't give you. They would try to relocate the child within a Kerala, Tamil Nadu, you know, Karnataka family, so the cultural, the facial features, everything is familiar. If not, then they will send for possibly or a Punjabi house. Here though, we just send children straight into a white man's house. And you know, you have these little brown children and black children and the Chinese children all going into a white man's house. So first thing, this is not on. But then human trafficking just breaks all these rules and goes ahead with whatever they have to do. So this is the problem with inter-country adoption. See, since they can't go, they under the garb of adoption they go. And out of the 100 children who are sent out for adoption, only 10 reach their adoptive homes. The rest are used for organs, for sex trade, for slaves, for games by these Saudi Arabian countries, for jihad, for a lot of things other than adoption. So it is basically child trafficking. Human trafficking has been there now, today. Mm-hmm. Above drugs, child trafficking is the human trafficking, women and child trafficking are the most lucrative business in the world.
So you got this case as a journalist,
right?
Yeah. When did you decide that you
No, it came to me as a to do a book.
Okay.
But being a journalist,
okay,
you know, it makes it easier for you because with all our experience we have of investigating and researching.
So investigating. Mm-hmm. And did you take it up with the various international organizations?
See, I had the research papers of how various international organizations like the Vatican, the United Nations, Mother Teresa's Missionaries of Charity, then you have a whole lot of organizations in India who are into child trafficking, and the Illuminati. I'm sure all of you have heard about the Illuminati, Dan Browns. So Illuminati really exists. It comprises of all these European royalty, hedge fund owners, presidents of America. Our very own Bollywood and Hollywood actors are part of the Illuminati. Thankfully, none of our Bollywood actors are part of the child trafficking racket. Otherwise, the presidents, the senators are all part of this. So, you know, so these are the organizations, internet organizations, like Hillary Clinton almost won the US presidential election. But the Illuminati has a shadow government in every first world country. So it was the Illuminati who put up Trump because they know he's a buffoon, he's an idiot. And you know, it's mentioned in my book also, so that they could run their illegal trades like trafficking and drugs and arms easily.
So the thing is that when you write about these subjects, so you are walking on a lot of toes, you know.
Right.
So what happens? I mean, do you, constantly, you had a lawyer by your side when you were writing it? How did it
No, work? I had a policeman by my side. I had a cop by my side. So I have a friend who was he's an IPS officer, and he would come plainly dressed, and he would sit in my car and go because I was dealing with all the drug dens and all. And once I told him, why don't you bring your car? He said, are you stupid? I have a red. But they'll all be alerted, you know. So he was there, and then of course the lawyer was there from the beginning to the end. I mean, the lawyer from ACT, every paper I wrote, every chapter I wrote, I would call him, I would read it out, so that he would say, okay, I don't have proof of this, so take this off, or we can work this out, I have enough documents. So that's how we work.
But you must have also realized, you know, that even if a person is innocent, if you happen to be on the wrong side of the law, then you are wrong.
Yes.
So for Jennifer, I mean, the intention was to get some relief to her, or to just put her case outside to the world. What was the intention?
The whole idea, because you see, Jennifer's case was, it was beyond her. When you are an 8-year-old and you're trafficked out of the country, what can you do? And she was trafficked out in a basket. She had no say. And then at 28, suddenly the country decides, according to adoption laws, if I am adopted and you haven't got my papers right, you have to get my papers right. I may be a thief, you may put me behind bars, but you have to get my, after I come out of prison. But America is a very smart country. They don't like somebody, they just want to throw out the person. And India is a very stupid country. The Indian ambassador sitting there said, you know, okay, fine, without even realizing, instead of, her name is Meera Shankar, that idiot ambassador, I don't know how she became an ambassador, instead of saying that, sorry, you have given her papers, let her serve a prison term, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, but then she is your citizen. She is not our citizen. She is married in America, she is American children, she has been there for 20 years. She is adopted by an American. But then she said, we love to bow to the white man's orders, quickly sign the papers, handcuff her, and send her on a gentle flight back to India. Now, for her, it was more a culture shock coming to India. It's not being physically abused in America. It's not being a drug hustler in America. But it's the fact of leaving her friend, her family, her children. And imagine leaving 3 and 4 year olds. So that was her trauma. And she didn't know the language. You know, here is this little dark Malayali girl speaking in American, accent, like she's saying, hey, hello, you do not, and the guys don't understand anything. So, yeah, like I remember when I went to Thane to meet her first. So I took my car and I said, I need to park the car near the Thane station. So she's looking and saying, come here, dude, Mahjo. Get me a part of the line. I didn't know what was happening because he didn't know what language he was speaking, you know? But he caught on to that word and that was enough.
So what is it, as your book comes out and released last year, so what is the status of Jennifer and how has it impacted her life?
It's become international, people are reading it, it's getting into a French translation. But legally, I think the law is the law, you know. But a lot of people have written on the net, on Amazon, that yes, we have also been in the same state as Jennifer and we have also suffered like her. So it's wonderful that you've written the book and that we can also get back to our roots, you know, that kind of stuff. So, and Jennifer, well, not much has impacted her life. The only thing that can is that just during the lockdown, finish the screenplay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so hopefully, you know, we are in talks with a production house. Once that gets sorted, once it's on the big screen,
it will have it,
on a OTT platform, then it will have a wider impact.
And human trafficking, as you researched this book, how serious is this issue and how rampant across the world?
It is very, very serious. Earlier it used to be arms, drugs, arms. Today, currently, it is more human trafficking. And more than human trafficking, it is women trafficking and child trafficking. Women come first because once a woman is trafficked out, she is made to produce 10 to 15 kids. So the value of a woman is far higher than a male labor being trafficked. And children, of course, are, as I said, used in various.
So these rackets are promoted by, you would say, very powerful
people. Very powerful people, of course. I mean, you have all these Illuminati, you have missionaries of charity, Vatican, UN. Without the help of these people, certain people in their organizations, this wouldn't have gone.
If I would say that poverty itself is the biggest reason, you know, for these.
Absolutely. Right.
So both ways it works. The one who's poor exploits his poverty, and the one who's in the giving position exploits that.
Absolutely. Like in Jennifer's case, her mother was a maid, her father was a drunkard, he didn't work, he was an electrician. Christian school so that she gets her education. And the mother kept thinking Jennifer's getting nice free education. Whereas they were busy trying to sell her to the US. They were getting money for her. and they liked your mother that she's going to be educated over there. Unfortunately, she was not.
But you have interviewed her parents also.
Her mother died by the time she had come back. Her father also died before I started the book. I've met her brother, I've met her hubby.
Would you like to read some portions? You know, I mean, some portions from the book.
Okay, let me see.
I mean, that gives the people a hand of the language I've written about it.
So I'll read this little passage where she is caught, busted for having drugs, and how she is deported. After a 2.5 hour journey to Detroit with a dozen other prisoners and a few guards in a van, Jennifer reached the Detroit holding cell, which was a holding place for lawbreakers and illegal immigrants. Little did Jennifer know what was in store for her in Detroit. The next day she was made to sit with a number of illegal immigrants, mainly Mexicans, and Jennifer wondered why. After all, she was an American citizen. "Where are you from?" she remembers Judge Hackett asking her over the television monitor. "Battle Creek, Michigan," Jennifer replied. "I'm asking you, where are you from? Which country?" Judge Hackett repeated rather firmly through the monitor. "The United States of America," Jennifer replied with confidence and defiance. "Please don't waste my time, Miss Ames. I'm asking you for the final time. Which is your country of birth?" "India," Jennifer whispered limply. "But Your Honor, I am Judge Hackett," cut Jennifer mid-sentence and said, "All right, Miss Jennifer Edgell Baines is to be deported to India as her papers are not in order. She continues to be a native, an Indian citizen and a resident of the United States and has overstayed a visit in this country without relevant legal documents, thereby making her stay illegal." Now, this itself was wrong, you know, because they should have said, "Okay, serve your prison term, but you are an American citizen." And they quickly passed on this paper to the Indian ambassador signed instead of the book. So, the, you know, this Indian ambassador, I hold her responsible.
But as you must have met Jennifer a number of times.
So,
what are your impressions? I mean, how has she taken this entire thing? Is she angry?
Of course. There is a, portion where she says that people say when you get lemon, you make lemonade out of it. Right? She said, but when you get a bunch of rotten lemons, what lemonade can you make out of it? So she's been sexually abused. She changed foster care home because she was abused there. She turned kleptomaniac. She turned a drug hustler because she married one. She was deported. She didn't know her parents. She had no passport. She had nothing. She left, missed her children, her family, everything. She started life again, got into the wrong company. And then I used to tell her, I said, "Jenny, don't take drugs, you know. I'm writing this book, you get into jail again and people will lose their sympathy for you." She said, "What do I do? Every time I go to get a job, and now we have Google. So they Google me and they know my background and you know she's been in the papers, news, everything. And I don't get a job. So what do I do? It's a catch-22 situation." She wants to do something but she can't. Then in fact, when she was arrested, I went to visit her in Baikala only for a few minutes and then the lawyer said, "Let her sit there for about 3-4 months and she'll come out of the room." Of course, they charge sheeted her and she came out. And it was very sad. Then she met Indrani Mukherjee, that she was a cellmate. And then she met this other woman, that hockey player smashed her husband to death with a hockey stick and all that. So it was all a crazy thing, you know. Her full mind is also jumbled up. So sometimes she's telling you this, next day she changes.
She doesn't connect with India at all.
Today she connects. She's been in India almost 12 years. She's got another 8 years to go. Her children have come to visit her. Her mother-in-law has come to visit her.
Husband
is in jail. So I had to interview him through his prison codes. So they have come, they've met up, they keep going. But I think, you know, he enjoys her life here. And in fact, she was saying after another 8 years, if I were to go back, my friends have moved on. Though she's in touch, they have moved on. And I think I'd like to be in India. Now, that's why she was like, when she started the book, she thought, you know, some magic it will take up. But she says, I'm very happy to be in India now. I may just visit the US, but I'd like to be in India.
And that, you know, as a journalist, as a woman, really, in this society, and they, you know, these similar stories we come across so many times. You know? So what happens is sometimes the society is very insensitive to these approaches. But as you research, Jennifer, and as you write a book, do you think there are sufficient support systems present in the society?
No.
Can such people, such women ever be accepted by the society and they return? What is the blight?
See, I'll tell you, in Jennifer's individual case, it is difficult for people to get back to a normal social life. In India, we have no such facilities provided. But in Jennifer's case, what happens also when you start selling drugs is very easy money. She sells such a small packet of cocaine for 5,000. She works in, you know, in a day she sells two, she's got 10K. In a week she makes 30-40K if she's selling. Whereas if she's coke and meth, but if she's working in a call center, she's going to get 15,000, 20,000, 25,000. So who is going to go all the way? For her, it's easy money. And also, I think somewhere she's mentally very harrowed and she loves that easy money. In her case, we've tried to rehabilitate her many times. She just leaves the job and goes back, you know. So I have got my gynec to, you know, give her a job in a clinic as a receptionist.
But they have reservations.
No, they didn't have reservations. I explained the whole situation to her. But she, in her, as I said, individual case, she doesn't want to. But not everyone is like Jenny. A lot of people want to go. Jenny wants a very fancy job, you know. Like in the US, they were big time smuggling drug hustlers. Her husband is a fourth generation Chicago drug hustler. Her mother-in-law has gone to Yale. She studied law, but they're all drug hustlers, okay? And they led a very nice life. Now here she can't get that, you know, with that money. She can't. So she's like very fed up. She doesn't want to go back. She wants an easy life. I told her, I gave her a job with Dr. Harish Shetty. How many of you have heard of him? The psychiatrist. So she's in Thane, he's in Andheri. You have to take a train and go. She says, you know what? I have to take a train and go. Yeah, I mean, he's not going to send you anymore. He's never ready to go. So she's just become very lazy.
I mean, she's also reconciling to the situation.
Yeah.
If I were to ask you, the condition when women get caught on the wrong side of the law, how is it, America, India, wherever, what happens to these women who are victimized, abused?
In the US, when she was caught with drugs, they undergo educational program, drug rehabilitation program, they get money for a certain period. So, you know, you can, over there it's much easier, you have nothing. You're just thrown out and then you see your background, nobody wants to give you a job. So it's a very, very sad situation. You know? But in the US also, as I said, Jennifer is an individual case. In the US also, when she was doing her drug rehabilitation program, she jumped that also. She took the money and jumped the program. So that is Jennifer.
Okay, so where does the book go now from here?
So the book
turns into cinema.
Yes. So during the lockdown, we worked on the screenplay of Jennifer first. The story as Jennifer's life, we had to change the end, like all film, we had to put in a lot of drama. We had to get around the beach. She has enough romantic elements, but we put in, you know, a much more stronger romantic element. And then we changed the end.
We changed the end. We had
happy
end.
We had a very happy ending. You can't have a sad ending in cinema. No one's going to go and see the film.
You know, hope alive.
Absolutely. And the ending is terrific.
Okay, thank you so much.
In the screenplay.
Thank you so much, Namita. All the very best for your book. Lovely chat. I hope you all enjoyed as much as I did. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Why did ACP want her life to be documented or to be showcased?
He wanted to show how she was trafficked out under the garb of adoption. We say adoption, it's not adoption, it's trafficking. It's child trafficking, basically. So that is why they, and there are many millions of cases from the organization Jennifer went, was trafficked out. 5,000 children now, and in different parts of the world. And they are settled, some of them dysfunctional. But they're doing okay.
So is there now some kind of a crackdown on this kind of the whole system and the whole
It can't, it's a huge, huge world. I'm telling you, the Illuminati, the Vatican, the UN, all, you know, so many important people. How do you crack all of them down at one go? They profit from child trafficking. Yeah. Good question. Now we have to see. See, I had approached Priyanka when she was doing Quantico, but that time the book had not been published. Only, you know, I roughly approached her. So that time she said, okay, let me see. I said, wait, let the book come out. And she said, I'm busy till 2021, of course, on a marriage and this and that. So now she's a little too old to play the Jennifer, but we'll see.
Do you have anyone in mind?
With a little American accent. See, if you're a good actor, no? If you're like Tapsi Pannu, or if you're a good actor, you'll get that accent.
She is the one who came to my mind.
Even currently, she is the one in my mind, but then.
Her personality. Yes.
Deepika is also one person who can. Ananya will not. We need more depth to Ananya. Deepika is perfect. And she can develop the accent easily. And she can play that age, you know, from say 18 to 37, 38. So yeah, you have Deepika and you have Tapsi.
Popular choices.
Who's the popular choice? But let's see. It's up at the end. The producers call. He has to see the budget. They have to see whether they can.
So when the movie releases, you all know that you had a stake in it.
If your cast works, then you guys were the casting directors.
you'll get the credits. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
At the outset, I would like to thank Ms. Nandita Okulika and Ms. Berta Bajur ma'am for joining us today. We wish we get to hear you all again and be equally enlightened as you all are today. And for my dear massive audience, I'm sure that after witnessing this conversation, you all are taking home an enriched perspective with you today, just as I am. So thank you for joining us today. Until I see you again, this is Alpi signing off.
Thank you.
Thank you.